You're good, Bob.
Hello, and welcome to the conference room. This is a series of brief presentations with high value impact on a variety of topics, which we have found to be of strong interest to any organization. This particular series is brought to you by our underwriter, RDO Consulting, LLC. Robert Orzechowski is the president of RDO Consulting, and we certainly thank the group for that support. The Valander Group is bringing you these programs as well, and if we can move to the next slide, we want to show you the programs began. This is the second program, and the first was on cybersecurity, basic security overview. The second program here brought to you with the Valander Group will focus on communications, but a little bit about the Valander Group. It's a veterans-owned and managed company. You can see the business partners there, Eric Robuck, and in addition to his many credentials, he's also a candidate for a master's degree in cybersecurity. John Roberts Robinson is our CFO, and Robert Orzechowski is the human resource officer. Dale Rothenberger is covering sales and business development and risk management. And Chuck Holder is our business strategist. That's who the Valander Group is as of this time. And we are looking forward to actualizing our mission, which is to improve organization performance across the operational spectrum of people and technology. The Valander Group also wants to remind you that this is not legal advice. The opinions expressed here are not necessarily the opinions of BCTV, the underwriter, or the Valander Group. Please consult with your IT advisors or the Valander Group before making any changes to your IT infrastructure. Okay, let's move on. And the title of this second program, Cybersecurity 101, and the paranoia that we all should be feeling in this area is not wrong if people are after you. Make no mistake, there are people out there to get you. And IDs and the personal information, identification theft, identity theft, these things are happening several times a second in America. And it's because there are people out there that are smart enough to steal and access databases and interrupt the secure communication between computers. And that's what this show is going to be about today, how computers communicate and what can we do to make them safe and secure. Okay, the learning objectives now, we're gonna turn it over to Eric, the president of the Valander Group. Go through the learning objectives, and we'll keep on moving through the program. Eric, over to you.
Thanks, Bob. I want to talk a little bit about how computers communicate, how they communicate securely, some of the threats and vulnerabilities that everybody faces and how to mitigate them, and how to get a basic understanding of how to protect yourself. What tools do we have to protect ourselves with, so that everybody can't, or bad guys can't, sit and watch everything that you're doing and use the information that they gather against you. How computers communicate is through something called a packet. So your computer will send out a packet to another computer that it wants to communicate with. And it starts by establishing something called the three-way handshake. So if I want to use the internet, when I use the internet, the only thing I'm really doing is communicating with another computer through a set of protocols. The protocol for the internet is HTTP. HTTP protocol dictates that there's a three-way handshake setup. The first part of that three-way handshake is called a SYN. So my computer sends a SYN flag to another computer. That computer sends an acknowledgement back to me, and then I send another acknowledgement acknowledging the acknowledgement. Then we can start communicating, and that's where it gets interesting. A packet is sent from my computer after that three-way handshake to say, here's what I want from you, or here's what I want to give to you. Inside that packet are many technical flags, many technical explanations that only the computer uses, but also inside that packet is the information that I want that computer to have. It can be an email that I wrote. It can be a message that I sent somebody. It can be a file. It can be my credit card information. It can be my social security number. Whatever I send over the protocol in a packet is exactly what that computer is going to get. The problem, here's where the problem lies. The problem lies when I send that packet through the air or through wires, and mostly it's through the air anymore. But when I send that packet, somebody can be doing something called sniffing. They can have a network sniffer collecting those packets. It's very, very simple to do. There's multiple programs like Wireshark that can sit and sniff packets and watch exactly what you're doing. Packets, of course, by default, are sent just in the plain text that you type them up in. So if I text, hello, Bob, I am glad you're hosting our show, that's exactly what goes over the wire. To mitigate that problem, there's something called encryption. Let me explain to you exactly what encryption is. Encryption is thousands of years old. Encryption, and this story is probably apocryphal, but the story goes that encryption started with Julius Caesar. Julius Caesar was sitting on top of one mountain, looking down into a valley at two armies getting ready to battle, and his other generals were on the other side of the mountain, on the other side of the valley. So how was he going to get a message over to the other side without it getting intercepted and read and having the enemy know exactly what he was planning? So what Julius Caesar did, being the genius that he was, is he wrote out a message. And then he added three letters, three spaces to each letter. So if he was an A, he made that A a C. If it was a B, he made it a D. And so on, all the way down the line to loop back around when you hit Z. So if somebody else got that letter, all they would see is gibberish. And if they didn't know exactly what he did, they would not be able to decrypt that letter and understand what he was saying. Thus, he was able to send secure communication back and forth and win that battle. I'm not sure if that's a true story, but it's a famous story. If you look at the picture on your screen, that's another ancient form of encryption. How this worked is they had the person trying to encrypt the data had a stick of a certain diameter. They would then take a piece of paper or whatever they were writing on, wrap it around that stick, and write down what their message was, and then unwrap it. And then they sent that wrap. Unless you had a stick of the exact same diameter that the message was written on, you could not decrypt it and read it. So again, it was safe. Now, is it super safe? Kind of not, because they could just keep trying different diameters of sticks until they got the right one and was able to read the message. Thus, encryption is not always secure. Modern day encryption uses mathematical algorithms to mix up the words to go from what we call clear text to encrypted text. So these mathematical ciphers have become an absolute war, Bob. So people will make a mathematical cipher with a secret key to use to be able to pass that data back through the cipher with the secret key to decrypt it. The bad guys, they're always doing their best to try to break these mathematical ciphers. Because if they can break them, they can read all the data that you're trying to send. If you want to get a very good idea of what encryption is, how it works, and what kind of war there is between the good guys and the bad guys, watch a movie called The Imitation Game. That's all about decrypting the enigma that the Germans had during World War II. They were able to decrypt it, and it had a profound effect on the war because we knew all of Germany's communications back and forth. So to sum up some encryption ideas, encryption makes clear text unreadable. Now, when you do encryption, you have a set of characters that are from all the ASCII character codes. So you have uppercase, you have lowercase, you have letters, you have symbols and exclamation points and question marks. You have all those in that encrypted message, so it is absolute gibberish. Nobody can read it unless they have that secret key to pass it through that mathematical function that encrypted it. In order to do that, you must decrypt it, and you must have the secret keys to be able to do that. Now, I want you to look at this Google page, right? So let's bring this back to us. Let's bring this back to modern day. Let's take a look at this Google page. So there's something called SSL, Secure Socket Layer. Another layer of that is TLS. Those are two encryption protocols on the internet to try to keep you safe, right? So how do I know if this page is encrypted? There's two ways to know that this page is encrypted. The first way is if you look at the address. Can you see, Bob, can you see the HTTP google.com?
Yes, I can. I was going to ask you about HTTP versus HTTPS. I noticed that both exist in different emails and website addresses and all that. And I was going to ask you to differentiate the two of those for the audience too.
Well, that's a coincidence because that's exactly what I was going to do.
How about that?
So if you look at this Google page, it says HTTPS. That is saying that this is an encrypted website using SSL. If there's only HTTP there, do not send anything over that web page that is at all sensitive. Don't put over your social security number, and you never should do that anyway. Don't put credit card information or any information that you don't want somebody else to see. Don't put that over this web page because it's not encrypted.
Also, Eric, excuse me for a moment, Eric. We see the word bit up there, and I know at the bottom of our all the background of all our slides has all the ones and zeros, the bits and bytes. That the bit locker here has nothing. Is that where all these bits and bytes are stored?
No. That's something we can discuss later.
Okay.
But I think that might be a little bit of a different subject. But moving on, if you take a look at the URL up where the address is, and you look to the right of it, there's a lock. Can you see that lock? There's a lock there.
Yes.
All the way to the right. That also says this is an encrypted website. So if you send anything over this website, the first thing that's going to happen is it's going to become encrypted, and your data will be encrypted. It'll go over the wires or through the air in gibberish text, and when it gets to wherever it's going, they have the secret key to decrypt it and read what you have written. That's how you stay secure on the internet. And on top of that, encryption has many other functions. Encryption, remember we talked about the CIA triad last time, Bob?
Yes, I remember that.
Yes, confidentiality, integrity, and availability. Encryption speaks to every one of those. It gives us privacy and confidentiality. It speaks to integrity, because if I send you a long message, I send you a long email, and I'm telling you to be someplace at 5 a.m., if I send that in plain text, somebody can change that to 6 a.m., right? We would never know it. But if I encrypt it, they can't change it. So the integrity of my message will always stay correct. Have you ever heard the term non-repudiation?
Not in the last day or two.
Okay. Non-repudiation is the concept that I can prove that you did something on your computer, right? So encryption, have you recently signed a document online where you just pressed the button and your signature was there? And
when DocuSign, yes. DocuSign, we use it a lot in remote working.
Absolutely. And did you ever sit and think, boy, this doesn't seem very secure. That's not even my signature. I haven't signed anything. That's where non-repudiation comes in. Because it's encrypted, and the certain way that it's encrypted, I can prove that you signed that on your computer. That came from your computer. I can prove it through encryption. That's non-repudiation. That's why you can be very, very confident in the fact that if somebody signed something on a DocuSign document, that you can go put back and prove that they did it without handwriting analysis, without proving it through that it looks exactly like their handwriting has always looked. It's done through algorithms and it's done through mathematical functions. Message authentication, that goes right with non-repudiation. If you send me an email and it's encrypted, I can be 100% sure that it came from you. It's not corporate espionage. It's not another country trying to send an insecure message to get my country to do something that I don't want them to do. It's none of those things. I know that you sent me that message. Another reason we use encryption is access control. So there's two types of encryption, right? There's symmetric and asymmetric. Now, we're not going to get into those too much, but what I want you to understand about asymmetric and symmetric encryption is asymmetric encryption has a public key and a private key. Symmetric only has public keys. So if I want to make 100% sure that you are getting this message and that you are the one decrypting it, I'm going to encrypt it with my private key, and you are going to have my public key. So I know that you can encrypt my data, and you know that it's from me because it was
so
my
key. Eric, when I get an encrypted message through remote working here, they always ask me to put in a password to allow me to see the encrypted message.
Right, that's two different things, and that's a really good question. So that seems like a form of two-factor authentication, right? So you are going to have their public key, and it'll decrypt it automatically. But they're also requiring you to have a password. Or another way to do that is to send it so that your phone will get a message, so that your phone will get a code before you can open that email. Those are very, very good secure ways to make sure whoever is opening the email is who should be opening it. You have your phone, which is something you have. You have your password, which is something you know. And the encryption, all the encryption algorithms came from the sender. So that makes it triply sure that you know exactly who sent it, exactly where they sent it from, and that you can be sure what they sent is what you have. Does that make sense?
Yes. Thank you.
Another thing that you can use for encryption is time stamping. You know when they sent it. You know that this wasn't sent 6 months ago and you're just getting it now, and the data that you have is very, very old. You have to know that it's now. Suppose you're in a military function and you're a general making decisions, You can't make decisions on six-month-old data. You need to make decisions on real-time data. Encryption's another way to know that this data was sent to me recently. And for the last thing I can say is that it proves ownership. It proves that that was your message. So encryption, encryption runs the gamut of functionality. You can do many, many things. You can have non-repudiation. You can keep your stuff, the things you're sending secret. You can make sure that it's not changed and that it's trustworthy.
Okay, that's we sure covered an awful lot of information here. I guess what I'd like to do is we've had some questions posed to us for I guess for the remote workers mainly. It's their concern, but even the home user, everybody's sending emails and texts from their workstations and laptops. I guess the first one is, are we guaranteed to be secure just because we're using what you said, SSL, secure socket layers? Am I guaranteed to be secure doing that, either work-related transactions or just personal emails from friend to friend?
Let me answer this, and I want everybody to hear what I'm saying because it's really, really important. When you're talking about cybersecurity, you're never guaranteed. Never guaranteed. You have to be very careful with everything. You're never guaranteed security. Remember that cybersecurity is a reactive science, not a proactive science. The only thing that cybersecurity experts can do is, number one, react to what the bad guys are doing, but number two, try to guess what they're going to do. So if there's a bad guy that went out there and decrypt and was able to break that encryption code, no, you are not 100% guaranteed, but you are far better off. You're far better off than not encrypting it. If you don't encrypt it, it's super, super easy to read what goes through. And even on your desktop, if you want to store something and you know that it's sensitive and you have a file that's sensitive and you store it on your machine, you're guaranteed that that's going to be secure until you leave your machine open and somebody sits down at it, or until somebody breaks in. Another way that you can keep those files, encryption is just not over the internet. It's also personally on my computer. So I have things like BitLocker that I can download and encrypt the messages personally on my computer. What that says is, if I encrypt a file and then put it into an encrypted email or an encrypted website, I have double encryption. So if somebody's going to read it, they need to break both those encryption codes. Which, is that possible? Absolutely. Is it probable? Absolutely not. Breaking one, is it guaranteed that it's going to be unbreakable? No. Is it extraordinarily unlikely? Yes. And it's even more extraordinarily unlikely if it's double encrypted. So there's three encryption programs you can use on your machine and download and encrypt things before you even send them. Does that make sense?
Yep. And so if we can download those, I guess people better know what they're doing or get some IT help, because they can get all wrapped around the axle and not be able to decrypt it themselves if they have to see it again. Is that likely?
Absolutely. If you encrypt something and you lose the password or you lose the key to reopen it, it's gone. It's absolutely gone. And that speaks to the world that we live in, right? There are folks out there trying to do harm. You are trying to protect yourself. Of course that comes with risks. Of course you have to be extraordinarily organized to make sure that everything you're doing is at your fingertips. If you don't do that, you are going to lose data beyond a shadow of a doubt. If you don't do these things, people are going to steal them.
Okay. In the 5 minutes we have left, there were a couple of more questions we wanted to go over that we got in. And on the real practical note for not just the remote workers, but the general public, how can we secure our emails?
Well, there's multiple ways. The first one is to, if you want to send an email message and you want to be super secure, I would type that email message into Word or into Notepad, encrypt that, and then send it through encrypted email. That will ensure as much as we can ensure your security, because they have to break two algorithms. The other one, the other way, is to put another factor on top of what you're doing. A good example is on Google. If you look at the lower part of a Google message, you can put security on that Google message. If you look at the bottom, you can press a button that says, make it so that this person gets a text message with a code to be able to open this mess, to open the message you just sent. So if you have it double encrypted and they have to have their phone with it to even with them to even try, that really, really secures you very well.
Okay, then we're down to a few minutes left yet. We have some closing comments. Last question to throw at you we got in was, can an encryption algorithm be compromised?
Absolutely it can. As I said, that's a war. There's a giant war going on with encryption that the bad guys are always trying to break encryption algorithms, and the good guys are always trying to make new ones.
Okay, well, I'd like to invite everybody to continue to watch these on BCTV. Our next program will be July 8th, and we're not sure yet of the exact time. We're hoping that we get into the studio by that point. We don't know yet where the studio is going to be available, if it's still going to be safe with COVID, and this is being recorded for you on Monday, June 22nd, bright and early in the morning. But I wanted to let you know that we are thankful to Eric Robuck, the president of the Valander Group. If you have questions or you want future topics to be addressed in the technology, risk management, human resource management areas, business strategy, let us know. You can send questions at valandergroup.com. We also have a fantastic website we would invite you to visit, and that's the www.valandergroup.com. The telephone number there, 484-638-4053. And again, we want to invite the previous programs, invite you to review those. They are online, archived with BCTV. The first one was cybersecurity with the CIA. And again, Eric, what was the CIA standing for?
Confidentiality, integrity, and availability.
So there we go. And we'll look forward to seeing everyone then. This program was brought to you by the underwriter RDO Consulting, LLC. Bob Orzechowski is the president of that company as well, yours truly. And Eric, any last words from the Valander Group president? We have another minute.
I would just say, make sure you stay safe. Make sure you encrypt, use SSL, and stay organized. Because if you're not organized, you're going to encrypt information and not be able to get it back. Remember, if somebody gets your information, they have it forever.
And we are planning a program for those of you out there that are wanting to know future topics. We are planning a program on passwords, phishing, and people, and a number of other cybersecurity programs, as well as others, human resource management, risk management, and more. Thanks so much for everybody there and the BCTV people for bringing you these programs. And Eric, we'll talk again on July 8th.
All right. Thank you.
Be safe, everyone. Goodbye.